questions. And I hope that what this can do is spur some conversation among some of us, thinking about, yeah, who are the networks of people that we need to be talking to? Who are the people that we might think of as different from us, but actually we share this common concern? And so, who do I need to be seeking out? And then we're gonna have a bit of conversation, and if there's time, we'll have some opportunities for questions. Push your button and your microphone. So we all get to be senior city staff right now. So, bearing with me here, thank you. Poor Noor, when she was leaving, she was so feeling so bad, and then she handed me, there they are, she handed me some of the questions. Noor is a journalist. And so I was really excited about the prospect that we would have a real journalist doing the panel discussion and moderating this part of it. But she's given me her crib notes, so I'm going to pretend to be a professional here. What I'd like to do is just take an opportunity. We'll work our way just down the panel this way. So if Sarah, if you would start, just introduce yourself and just briefly, what's your connection to this issue and to Faith in the City?
Well, my name is Sarah Doucette. I am a local city councillor. My ward is High Park. I'm also a mother, two beautiful children. So my connection with Faith in the City was 3 years ago, Councillor Mahevic and Joe came to me and said, would you like to be involved in Faith in the City? And I said, well, you know, what is it? And when they told me what it was, I said, yeah, exactly. And if you stick around after this panel, you'll see a little bit more about why I wanted to join Faith in the City and how I connect it. So happy to be here. I know I only found out yesterday I'm on the panel, so be nice to me, okay?
My name is Soraya. I live in Regent Park and work at the same time in Regent Park. I call it 24 hours. So I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Joe, for including me with this.
I'm Nene, community worker, organizer, youth advocate. I guess my most direct connection is the work I do with the African Canadian community and the fact that poverty in the African Canadian community is so severe and significant. I'm also a parent, so I understand the relevance.
I'm Jasmine. I am a community worker as well. I work with young people who are homeless, marginalized, and have mental health issues. What connects me to this, I grew up as that one in four that lives in poverty, and I also spent some time being homeless.
Thank you. Thank you. We're so grateful for all of you and the breadth of experience that's on this group. I'd like to just invite you to share a little bit about what you've heard people discussing and brainstorming today on child poverty. And is there something that caught your attention this morning? Is there something that stood out when you think back over the day? What's the thing that you'll remember? Oh yeah, this thing happened, or somebody said this thing.
Too many things. So I tried to jump around all the different workshops. I managed to get to 4 out of 5, which I think in 75 minutes wasn't bad. Transportation. One thing which sort of hit me, the person who was running it said something about when the city was thinking of allowing children under 12 to go ride for free, how many parents would have to send that child out to do the errands? Send that child to go grocery shopping? Is it safe for that child under 12 to do that, because maybe the parent can't afford to take that bus or that subway? That, I hadn't even thought of that when we thought we were doing good things. So that's one thing which hit me.
Okay, great, thank you. Anyone else?
I would say the video was kind of light for me when I saw those animated, the way everything, oh, exactly, that's what I see everything in my community. Why don't everybody see what I see? What kind of action do we have, everybody has to take in order to remove those, all the barriers that I saw in the video? That was my, the light moment.
I think the discourse lacked for me so far a focus on community efficacy or community agency. We didn't talk about community economic development. I think the tone and focus for me ought not to be how can government help people out of poverty, but how can all of us, private and public sector, community, work together in ways that are different to attack structural inequities like poverty. So for example, we haven't yet talked about corporations and big businesses and the hundreds of millions of dollars that banks make in profits, or Bell and Rogers, or Nike and Reeboks, all of those folks who benefit tremendously from the way we arrange capital, and whether their corporate or social responsibility ought to be more than a few summer jobs here and there. Whether there's some structural things they can do around massive infusions of investments in certain communities, around scholarships for young people, around major economic development activities within communities that promote entrepreneurship and reduce barriers to loans, and so on. So I think, for me, the discussion has the potential to move beyond how the government can help individuals to how communities, businesses, and the government work together creatively to create the kind of partnership that will make meaningful change.
Great, thank you.
Just briefly, something that really stood out for me in the different conversations that I've been listening to was a real need to shift how we view poverty and how we view the poor, as we're calling them, and just creating a fundamental shift around that.
Okay, so if we're looking back a little bit, go a little further back, kind of how did we get here? Well, let's, you know, we try to keep things optimistic, but let's be honest, solutions that we put forward that just aren't working. There's things that we're, solutions, but they're not solutions, they don't work. What's failed? What's failed and what's worked well? Let's look hard at some of the things that just don't work. What are your thoughts?
I think one of the things the city has done is all our high-rise buildings. When you built the high-rise building, you forgot to put that needed infrastructure in around it in many areas. We've heard talk about the food deserts. So if someone, again, I'm going back to transportation, if someone can't afford to take a bus to get to a grocery store, and the nearest thing to them is McDonald's and a corner store, what are their children going to be eating? So it's that vicious circle where you need people in mass housing in some areas, but you didn't put the infrastructure there for them to be able to walk, which shouldn't just be a convenience, it's a necessity, walk to what they need to be able to provide for their families, whether it's actually a job. Walk to a job, walk to your grocery store, walk to your school, walk to your community center, your library. That's the building, that's the city I think we should be building. And if we have apartment neighborhoods and any developer is coming in to build, they should be made, one, to put affordable housing in their buildings, but two, to build some infrastructure which is missing.
We don't have to always go in a row here. Anybody else want to jump in here? What's not working?
I would say I work for the organization and we had a vision and mission, but at the same time I see a lot of barrier, when it comes to the food, it's very dangerous. They say, who's gonna do it? They are very good at, especially you taste the food that right now, today, that being catered. I took initiative in my hand and I said, we have to do with this. And so the community members, the family will benefit from this. This is not our mission. If it's not our mission, let's make it our mission. So we could help the families who are very good at and excellent what they are making and proud of what they are making. And if it's not our mission, let's make it. It's very dangerous. What is that dangerous? Isn't it dangerous to be in poverty and being poor? That's dangerous, I will call it. I think sometimes we have very good intention that we create and mission and vision, but at the same time we need to revise, is it working? Who are we doing for it? Are we serving the community that we are living? If it was the mission 10 years ago, I think we have to put it in the garbage and revise what kind of vision and mission that those community needs in order to accept what their vision is.
What kind of economic hubs can we create in different geographical areas that will attract folks and help to train, sustain, and nurture them with the appropriate resources? How do we get the academy, the corporate sector, the government, and communities working together to track and monitor and manage and train and build capacity and so on and measure? How do we get faith communities to understand what anti-oppression actually means? And how they're going to work together to attack it through a social justice lens in a way that is, dare I say, radical. How do we give hope to young people? There are a fantastic arts program that Toronto Arts Council has funded in years past that provides support for young people to be innovators and entrepreneurs and creators and so on. Through building infrastructure and significant training and capacity building resources. And many of them have gone on to do amazing things. I think we can build on some of those things. So I'm not proposing it's all doom and gloom. There are lots of good things to build on, but we have to focus on community and not just individuals. And it has to be, in my mind, very targeted as well. Poverty in racialized communities, in some communities, is more than 80%. 80%. In Toronto Ridge. So we have to bring a race lens to this as well as a gender lens. Poverty is increasingly racialized and feminized in our city. So do we need to have targeted initiatives that address racism and gender oppression and exclusion and so on? And how do we ensure that the people who are most affected have strong voices in the decisions that are going to affect them? So young people and single mothers and so on should be very involved in that process.
I think that one of the things that sort of I feel hasn't worked is when we have conversations like these, we have to ask ourselves, who are we including and who are we not including? Who is at the table, who is not at the table, and why? I find that a lot of these sort of higher level conversations are excluding the communities that we really want to impact, and I think that with communities that we're working with being present, it adds another depth to the conversation as opposed to, I don't know, like fear that they won't understand or something like that. So just finding that conversations like this and others that are a little bit exclusive.
So we can talk about the things that aren't working. Some of them, the thought is that we need to throw them in the dustbin. Others that we need to ask, why aren't they working? So, well, how do you take something that's not working and make it work? Inclusiveness, who's at the table? You talked about focusing on the need for community.
Agency.
But how do you do that? What's the mechanics for a community like this? How do we get there?
Build relationships that are trusting and inclusive and respectful. You build good relationships that are trusting and respectful and inclusive. You identify and connect with community leaders and young people on the ground doing the work who have credibility, and you listen well, and you build on what has worked, and you're open to new ideas and suggestions. And you use social media.
Yeah. How long does that take? I'm not against social media. I'm just no good at it. I just don't get it. But that takes a long time to do those things. Like, to build those community relationships, you can't do that in a month or 6 months. It takes a long time.
But you have to start somewhere. Mm-hmm. So in order to build where you want to go, it will take time, but at the same time, there will be awareness when the media is out. That way, the people who you don't know, we become individual society, like in the morning someone mentioned. I think we need to go back and revise. We need to be the wholesome, the community that will care. So we are individual, but at the same time, how we could be and using the social media to have awareness. Yes, there is people who live in Regent Park under poverty, but at the same time, how can let Kabi Town people know about this exists? I'm just going to share some story that took place. We were featured in CBC in December. So this year, 2 weeks ago, she's anonymous. She lives somewhere in Kabi Town, and she reached out to me, and I heard about your story. I want to help you. She didn't reach out to executive director, but she reached out to me, and I'm going to give you money that you could help the community members in order to elevate what you are doing, make it accessible, and don't mention my name. I will help you any way I can in order to make it that you could help more people. So she saw that in CBC. So that's how she reached out to me, and she didn't ask me any receipt or income tax or whatever, and she said that we need to have one bank account, she says. So we all one human being. So the people who are less fortunate could have opportunities that people are enjoying the rest of the society and the rest of community. So I think this is the example of way we could reach out those people who are invisible for other people.
And I think it's also like changing the structure, and like in addition to what you guys have said, changing the structure, thinking about how we do things and thinking outside of that. So for example, going back to the point on conversations, if a parent can't take a day off work to be here, well, how do we have this conversation in a way that would fit with their schedule, their lifestyle, their whatever's going on in their lives? And it's almost like a cultural overhaul in how we operate, and finding the community leaders and those people who maybe, you know, they don't have a job title of, you know, director of such and such or whatever, but on the ground they're known as the go-to people. These are the community leaders, and really connecting with them to get in and working with those communities, that can be a real asset.
I think you'll find in every community there are very active people. And I think what we can do is connect those people. When we're dealing with youth, we've got to, first of all, try and understand what they're talking about. That language seems to change weekly, whether it's on Twitter, Facebook, or just when you're talking to them. Even my own daughter suddenly throws a word at me, and I go, "Yeah, sorry, what does that mean?" So I think we have to talk to them, though, and ask them. So we've given you this amazing program. We've given you this amazing rec center. Why aren't youth coming to it? What are we doing wrong? You know, we open up to basketball. We open up to something else. Why aren't people coming? So we've got to go to the people we're trying to help and give them the power to have and the trust to come back and say, well, you know, we don't want to play basketball Sunday 10 o'clock in the morning. We want to play basketball Saturday evening at 8 o'clock. Or something. That sounds really simple, but it may be that simple. We've got programs. We heard earlier that not everyone knows about the programs we're doing, but we've got to talk to those people who we are doing the programs for and say, can you help us? What are we not doing right, or what are we doing right, and what should we do better? So go to the people we're meant to be working with.
I'd like to know if there are questions for the panel. Are there? No? We've got our microphones. Over here, okay. Are you there, Milo? Okay. Down there, keep your hand up so they can see you. Who's got a question? And please let's keep them. I've been trying to ask questions, so let's try to keep them as questions so the panel can respond.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm not sure if there is a movement afoot in terms of getting the real estate developers to create public spaces within their development sites for not only multi-faith activities, but for public activities as well, whereby groups of people can come together, not only to share resources, such as skills, goods, and services amongst one another, to enable those people to become more empowered to do other things for themselves, to become more economically viable, so to speak, and to address the gentleman's concern about social entrepreneurship, to enable that to happen more frequently amongst people. Because for me, that's a foundation towards not only individual health, but also public health as well, and also is the foundation towards community prosperity.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody from the panel want to respond to that?
I mean, every time a developer comes to us with a proposal, every site is so different. I have one building being built right now, which does have a beautiful courtyard in the front, which is going to be a public space. It's going to be for the community to use. It's going to be up to the community to decide how they want to use that space. If the faith groups want to come and have a church service there, or a service there, or a blessing there, then it's public space, and I would encourage that most definitely. Not every development can work that way, but I have a couple of churches in my ward where they don't have congregations anymore. So developers are now coming in to change the churches. And they're such stunning buildings, they want to make them into condominiums, and I'm okay with condominiums, but I'm not wanting them to knock down this beautiful structure and do something else. But that might be the time where, I know there's one in Mimico, where they're keeping the congregation and they're adding some seniors apartments to it. So we have to, I'm maybe not quite answering your question, I'm sorry, but it's bringing everyone together and making people aware that each development we have an opportunity to do something different.
How can faith groups and other groups know about these so that they have input as to how to, influence the design of the development?
Okay, so the question. Yeah, the question, let me just repeat it for everybody. So the question coming again was, so how can faith communities have input on something like this around development?
Get involved with your city councilor. City councilor knows every single application which comes into their area, and planning knows every application, so contact your city councilor and ask them to be notified.
There was a question over here. Or did anybody else from the panel want to react to that? No? Okay.
Thank you. I wanted to raise the issue of open data, which the city is doing quite a lot to make data available, and they're chipping away at it anyway, and this is a really good thing. In our community, everybody in this room, I would venture that we're not very good at sharing data, let alone sharing it with the city. But if we really want to address some of these problems, we really need to know on the ground what's happening, and what it's costing, and what the best solutions are. And a lot of the best solutions don't come out of big government, they come out, stuff happening on the ground. So we need to create some trust between ourselves and share more information.
Thoughts? Agreed? All in favor? Lydia, over here, yes.
I notice in a lot of the discussion, we often come back to the dynamic of what can we do to help these communities. And we had the comment, for example, with Hugh Sagala said, you know, poor people are less likely to answer polls, We know that voting, even people who are more educated are more likely to vote, and or even we have a meeting like this. It's on a work day. It's, you know, it's downtown. The only reason I was able to come is because I'm unemployed. But
me too.
Yeah. How can we change that dynamic so that it's less what can we do for people and more like how can we support? How can we be more than a support? Other people be more in a supportive role, while the people who actually need these things be the ones who are taking a leadership role.
So how can we make this more?
How can we make it be more, I don't know, grassroots and make sure that we are actually supporting people in what they say they need and what they express as being their needs, rather than kind of looking back and, you know, going every once in a while and asking, but sort of making decisions top down for other people.
Well, that picks up.
So I live in Regent Park and work, kind of like you don't have a break. I enjoy what I do, but that means I respond what they want, which is I don't imagine and do whatever I want or our organization wants, but I do what people wants. Even it has to be in the weekend or opening the center on the weekend, even though it's not my job, but I have to do it. If something needs to be done, I have to stay up late, I have to open in the weekend. I have to commit to make it happen. Instead of pointing out somebody else, why don't you open or why don't you do it? So a commitment, which is that makes it different in individualist life. So, yeah.
I would also add, looking at how information like events like these or other things are circulated, and whose hands does it get into, and whose hands does it trickle into. You know, I had no idea that this kind of a thing was even existing if it wasn't for a connection through a connection that told me about this. So just looking at who are we passing on information like these, and so in that way, you know, over time it can become more of like a grassroots, more of a, instead of us, let me help you, it's how do we work together, and it's not just top down hierarchical thing.
Back to communication again, isn't it? Talking to people, but listening to people. And if we don't listen, if we're the ones putting the program out there and we're not listening, as I mentioned, the programs may not be being used. So it's a lot of communication.
We talked in our group about having localized economic summits at times that young people and working families are available to actually have folks understand what is happening locally and what the opportunities are to build on good things that are happening and how to involve, coordinate, integrate, and align more purposefully. So I look around the room and there are very few young people here. The demographic is fairly homogenous. And as you said, it's, you know, a working day and so on. So there are some access issues and so on that I think we all know about when we're doing these things. Well, grounding this in community is never a wrong way to go. Geographic communities as well.
Food. A, access. I is employment, but I would change it to income. T, transportation, and H, housing. So that spells faith.
Wow. You thought
you do you want to sit on the committee? Maybe you could be in like promotion and stuff like that.
My question is though, do you think panel think that there's more that faith in the city could do? If you think about collective impact and backbone organizations, it seems to me what I've observed is that you've all kind of come here and you've sort of selected faith in the city as a backbone organization. Backbone organizations through the Tamarack Vibrant Community System are the guide for things. They don't do a lot, but they sure pull things together to guide. And I wondered if you might see that as an opportunity for faith in the community.
So the reason we chose the five topics, I love your idea, and I wish we had come up with that idea, so thank you. We will take credit for that, even though we didn't. We actually came up with 5 topics in connection with what Deputy Mayor Pam McConnell is doing. She talked earlier about having everything in the palm of your hand and having her 5 topics. That's where we actually came up with those topics, because we do have a mayor who is on the same wavelength as us, which is refreshing. I'll say that carefully. And if you have a mayor who's on that wavelength, then we have Pam McConnell, who people don't say no to her. But as she said, it's not the I, it's the we. And so we chose those topics to help listen to what the faith community can help us move this poverty forward. To eliminate poverty if we can, we know it's probably not possible, but what can we do in our communities to help those who need not always need help, they need maybe just a step up, maybe they need somewhere to find that job. Most people don't want a handout, they want to be able to improve their own situation and then go from there. So I don't want to just give someone a plate of food and say, here, I'm feeding you for this day. I want to give them the ability to go and feed their family for the week and the month and the year. So, but as I said, I do love your idea of faith. I think we should think of that one for our next year's topics. Thank you.
Question up there, Milo.
I'm just wondering, a couple of the panelists have raised the question of the communities that we are talking about are not here. I'm just wondering whether it's possible for those communities to, at their level, decide what would be good for them, and then approach Faith in the City and have it organized that way, so that they are telling us what would be helpful for them.
Can I just say that I, while sitting here, have received a tweet from one of the ministers in my ward who has said, why don't we in Ward 13 do a poverty reduction workshop ourselves? And we can then include all of those in our community which weren't able to come here today. And I've already tweeted back saying, great idea. So modern technology is wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Alexa. So I agree. So I agree, we need to get into the communities and have them involved as well. That's why we've got beautiful panelists here who could probably make that happen.
Okay, one more question.
So what I was sort of getting at with the communities we're representing not being here, is I'm actually looking at it from a sort of a power lens, an anti-oppressive lens. And I'm looking at it from the sense of, you know, yes, it's very important that we're out in our communities and having these conversations there. And how do we bring those voices to levels like this, where decisions can be made, where people of influence are listening, where we're in City Hall having this conversation. There's a power dynamic and a power shift that would happen in that type of a conversation. So yes, I'm totally in support of us going into our areas and talking about this and bringing those voices here where we are.
I think we're nice and polite and liberal Canadians. And we slide over things and swerve around things. And I've mentioned a couple of times the issue of racism, homophobia, as things that are significant markers and contributors to poverty, pernicious poverty in those communities. No one has responded to those things specifically. I think we would be well served, for example, if we had members of the LGBT community tell us how poverty is manifested for people who are lesbian and gay, bisexual, transsexual, and queer. And we would be jarred by what we hear. Sit down with some black folks and ask them the same question. We'd be jarred by what we hear. Sit with some Muslims and ask them the same question and have them give you specific, focused life experience responses. Those things, I think, will best inform any strategy we're going to develop. We can't be generic and nice and general and vague. We have to drill down to to the most vulnerable, the most marginalized, and the most impacted segments of our community to find out the scope and nature of what we're talking about so our responses can be real. So all responses can be real.
I think the face of our gathering today would look very different if childcare would have been provided.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We started doing that in Regent Park and collaborating with FIT in Regent Park, that I will see the transformation. Kevin is here. So very supportive of the faiths in Regent Park. It doesn't matter what religion you have, you are a human being. So you need help. If you need help, we will help you. So collaboration, capitalism is here, it's not gonna go anywhere, but at the same time collaborating, the developments, whoever you have facing in wherever you, where you live, collaboration is collaboration, the solution, I would say.
So we talked in our group very briefly about the responsibility that the faith community has to critical self-reflection and building their own appreciation and understanding of anti-oppressive practices so that that work will provide the kind of authentic impetus that is needed to do the work we're talking about in a way that recognizes the strengths but also some of the challenges that the community might face given we're at right now. I think also our language, you know, which comes from, I guess, an ideological framing around helping those people, as opposed to what the gentleman said in terms of us working together. Communities are not the problem. Communities have problems related mostly to structural issues, structural barriers, and so on. And so they come with assets and strengths and gifts that we have to incorporate consciously in our thinking and our language around how we engage and support folks in building capacity as opposed to simply helping them. It's their money, it's their tax dollars. We're not helping them.
I also think it's important to ask ourselves, and it's important for me to ask myself, what role have I played that could contribute to the state of our society? What role have I played personally? And it's a hard question. It's like, it's one of those things where I'm like, I like sometimes want to break down and cry and realize that I've been oppressing somebody else. Like he said, like how we are intertwined, our liberation is connected, you know? So it's asking, genuinely looking at yourself and asking, what have I done to contribute? For example, if I'm in a position of power to hire somebody, who am I hiring? Am I looking at my work environment and am I looking at it and asking, is it equitable? Is it representative of the community that we're working with? Or is it not? And that's, I think that's a very tangible way of doing it. If you're in that position, if you're in a position to take people on board your team and volunteers and things like that, are they reflective of the community that you're in? And if they're not, then why not?
Okay, final question. Are you optimistic about the future? How do you not despair?
I'm so optimistic. No, I'm serious, because honestly, I believe that like, if you don't have hope, you don't have anything. And so I think that we're moving in the right direction. Like I'm holding on to that.
Absolutely. Young people are geniuses, shine and bright and full of energy and ideas and optimism, and they haven't lived long enough to be as pessimistic as some of us. I'm just brimming over with all kinds of ideas and creativity, and I think we just have to continue to appreciate it and harness it well. Communities have all kinds of assets that we have undervalued and under-recognized that are yet to be mined. So I'm very excited and optimistic.
I would say the same, and I will see the light coming and also ready for a change and see the future. Something good will come out of this beautiful gathering also. Thank you.
I was told I was on this panel because I'm an optimist. mean, look here. Look who we've got in this chamber today. All of you work so hard for your communities and what you do. If we weren't optimistic, we'd go home, bury our head in the sand, and not come out. But we are optimistic, and every day we get up and we go, wow, sun's shining, or hey, it's raining, that's good for the ducks. You've always got to look at that bright side of things. And as we heard, we've got the most amazing youth out there. We just got to learn how to talk with them, not at them, but with them. As I say, my daughter, she's 19, she has a language I don't understand. Optimism is there. We have to keep smiling. We have to be optimistic. What a beautiful city we have. What beautiful communities we have. And I hope everyone goes out after today. Give someone a hug. Shake a hand. Tell them we do live in a beautiful world, in a beautiful city. And then come back next year and tell us all your stories and what we've changed. So yeah, I'm optimistic.
And we need a plan. And some accountabilities, and measurements, and deliverables, and all of that stuff.
I want to really thank the panel, each of the members of the panel, Sarah Bissett, and Saray Ibrahim, and Jose Capelle, and Jasmine Ali, and for stepping in and stepping up and taking a chance to be in front of all of you. I would also like, this is a rhetorical question, I'm not asking you to answer it right now, but to think about, are you optimistic about the future? Why don't you despair? What is it that keeps you going? And take those into your conversations as we go forward. I'd like at this time to thank the panelists. And I'd like to invite Sarah Bissett, actually if you need to go over there. Sarah is going to take a few minutes to...